topic that we need to cover. It's monitoring and controlling the project. And this lecture is going to focus on the first part, which is only monitoring the project. So please turn off the computer screens and let's try to focus on the material for today. You can find, or if you're interested in reading from your textbook, this topic is covered in chapter 7 of your textbook. As always, I refer back to the course objectives, so we have covered all of them. And this one in particular, this lecture, goes back to the first two objectives for this class, which are be familiar with project management body of knowledge and understand the applications, issues, and current development in project management. So here's the agenda. We're going to go over these three, four topics. Monitoring and controlling, basically explaining what is monitoring, what is controlling, and why is that is important. And also the cycle, which involves some reports and meetings. Then we're going to talk about something that is very important, not only for this course, but also for most of the things that you do as an industrial engineer, is data collection. So if you don't know how to collect the data, and also how to process that data to make it useful for what you're trying to achieve, then you're going to have problems. So we're going to go over this data collection, what are the issues, why it's important, and for sure you're going to see that a couple of times before you graduate in this program, or from this program. And then finally, we're going to talk about what is the earned value analysis and how that helps you to monitor and control your project. So that's the agenda for this lecture. So at the end of this lecture, you should be able to understand the issues related to monitoring and controlling the project, describe the plan monitor cycle, plan monitor and control cycle, and describe the strategies for data collection and reporting. So I think it's very clear what we're trying to achieve with this lecture. Again, this is very important. You will be in charge of projects at some point in your career, and if you're not able to monitor the progress of your progress, then you might be, you might end up falling behind schedule or spending more money than you should. So monitoring, again, is very important, and controlling, for instance, the expenses of your project is very important. So let's define, in general, what these two concepts are. So monitoring is collecting, collecting, recording, and reporting information about the project. So as what with the concept that you have learned in class and topics and everything that we have discussed in class, who will be interested in this information? If you are the project manager, who is going to be interested in this information that you're going to be reporting? There are multiple people who are going to be interested in knowing about the status.
Customer,
correct? Right, management? And you can also say that your employees, they might need to know what is the progress of the status of the project. So it's very good. Now, in terms of controlling, uses this information to bring actual performance into agreement with the plan. So what you're trying to do here is just see if you're behind schedule or if you're above the schedule, what you have planned. If you're behind schedule, then you might need to proceed and bring some resources from other areas or find out what else we can do. Maybe you need to crash some of the activities to bring the project back to the agreement with the plan. So that is what's controlling. Next, we have the cycle, the plan monitor cycle, plan monitor and control cycle. But before we get to that, you know that managing projects involves continually planning what to do, checking on progress, comparing progress to plan, taking corrective action, to bring the project to agreement, and finally replanning when needed. So those five bullets basically give you the general steps or tasks that you perform when you're managing a project. The fundamental items to be planned, monitored, and controlled are these three things that we have been discussing every lecture. Basically, the time, cost, and scope. So those are the three things that you are going to be planning for, monitoring, and controlling. The plan, monitor, control cycle constitutes a closed loop process that continues until the project is completed. And next, I'm going to have a figure that is illustrate the information and authority flows for such a cycle in an engineering project. So what you're going to observe in the next figure or table is that information is going to start from the engineering level, project management level, and then it's going to go above this engineer to administration, and from there we'll go up on the ladder until it gets to the board of directors and so on. So the information will go from the person who is responsible from the project above up to the top of the company, and then from there it's going to flow down one more time until it gets to the approval and the initialization of the project, and then from there you're going to start providing some reports about the progress of the project, and that information will go up and down depending on the status of the project. So again, the information flows up the organization and the authority in terms of what the things that need to be approved and done is going to flow down from the top management up to the project manager. So most of the time you need to set up a system or maybe a strategy in order for you to be consistent in monitoring your progress. You have seen some tools here in class that can help you with that, like Microsoft Project. You can set up that schedule, those Gantt charts, and then using those bars you can find if you're behind schedule or not. But in addition to that, the key to setting up a monitoring system is to identify the special characteristics of scope, cost, and time that need to be controlled in order to achieve the project goals as stated in the project plan. And one way of linking the planning and control is to monitor the project progress at each milestone or phase of the project. So, let's say you set up some general or macro objectives or tasks for your project. You can think about them as your milestone, and then once you finish one of those major tasks, you can check on the progress or monitor the progress of your project. And as an alternative, you can monitor your project using Microsoft Project. That can help you to monitor the project continuously, so you can basically follow the Gantt chart. And the original Gantt chart provides the baseline, and every time there is a change, the tracking Gantt chart could be updated to reflect a change. Another way to monitor your project, which is going to be discussed later in this lecture, is to use an earn value chart with a pre-established baseline. And we haven't covered that yet. We're going to cover that as part of this lecture. That's another strategy that you can use to monitor your project. Something that's very important is to remember to number and save each version of the monitoring documents. So you don't want to save on top of something that you did before. So what I usually recommend is for each document you provide in the name of the document, once you save it, you provide a version. Let's say version 1, 2, 3, and you go up to a number. Or you can put the date. Like, you see minutes for the meeting, the name of the meeting, and then put the day after that. So that's something that have worked for me, and I have seen other people doing it as well in companies. So ensure that a timely and accurate record for the project history. So again, save everything that you write and try not to save on top of something that is present for previous meetings. Common errors is in setting up monitoring systems include only monitoring easy measures instead of relevant . And this is something very common. You try to avoid spending time collecting data. So you try to gather easy information. For instance, you can, instead of having people collecting the output of the production machine, let's say, you can easily go and talk to the person in charge of or supervising that production line and ask for an estimate. That's something that can that happens. So instead of looking at the personal opinion of someone, you can establish a monitor system to be sure that you're collecting the right information. Monitoring activity in place of results So if that production line is always producing items, you can assume that everything is going well, but that's not necessarily true. So you need to monitor the results in terms of the output of that production line. Monitoring inputs as surrogates for outputs and finally, monitoring measures that do not change from one period to the next. Okay, so bad thing about these topics is that there's a lot of information that needs to be conveyed from the instructor to the student. So it can get a little tedious changing, or the pace is a little slow. So that's why I would like to have a lab at this point. And this is a question that is going to be based on your understanding of the concept so far in this class. This is going to be a lab for your class. And basically the idea is to see if you are following up in terms of the things that we need to do as a project manager. So the question is, when making an estimate for the time and cost to execute a project, should the time and cost required to develop the planning, monitoring, and controlling system be included as well? Should the actions required to monitor and control the project be included as part of your project plan or work breakdown structure?
So these are things that are going to affect the project, but I want to know, based on what you think and your understanding, if those things should be planned as well and be part of the project plan or the work breakdown structure. So you can join your teammates and work on this lab in groups of three.
But actually, there's a right answer, but you can have your answer and justify it.
I'm going to give you about 5 minutes, so you don't have a lot of time to finish this. So the answer again for both questions is yes. Are we guys, are we done? Sir, are we done?
Me?
No. Fernando. Okay? Yeah. Okay, so yes. The time and cost required to develop the planning monitoring and controlling. Should be included in the budget. So again, this is gonna, these are activities that are gonna involve some of your resources. It's gonna require some preparation in terms of defining what will be those milestones that you will monitor and what are the performance that you should expect for each milestone. And similarly, the actions require to monitor and control the project should be included on the work breakdown structure or the plan. These are essential tasks for the successful or successful completion of the project. So basically, what the purpose of this question is just to make sure that you understand that these planning and controlling activities need to be planned ahead. They need to be part of your plan, and you need to make sure that that's part of what you're trying to do when you're planning for your project. Okay, any questions? Because now we're going to transition to a different topic. Also part of monitoring and controlling, planning for your project, and is the data collection and reporting. How many of you have taken any Dr. Jimenez simulation course? 1, 2, 3. Dr. Shimbapur also taught the class, so some of you took the class with him. Good. So I'm pretty sure that some of you, those of you who took the class, have seen some of the data collection and data analysis, and how is that translated to developing your models and your analysis in terms of your performance and conclusion. So that also applies to project management. So once we have decided on the type of data we want to monitor, the next question is how to collect this data and turn them into information useful for the project. So it's not only collecting the data, there's a process in terms of when are you going to connect the data, how many trials are you going to be collecting, at what time of the days are you going to be picking up that information, and so on. So it's a very involved process, takes a lot of time, but it's very important not only for your project but also to control and monitor the steps of your project. So at some point we have to decide what data we need to collect and precisely how to go about collecting them. So a number of questions you can ask. Should we design and use a special form? So at some point, again, you're going to be looking at different tasks.
you might need to develop a form for collecting the data for each one of those tasks. That will include the time in which you're going to collect the data, how many data points, what type of information are you looking for, if you're looking at time intervals, if you're looking at the number of activities, the count of activities, and so on. So that data be collected just before or after important milestone. Should time and cost data always be collected at the same time each month? So if you want to be consistent with some patterns, let's say you're looking at a specific operator, then you might need to collect the data at specific times of the day. But if you're looking at more randomness in your process, let's say you want to see at any time of the day, any workers, what will happen with that activity, then you might need to use a different strategy. So, the majority of the data to be collected will eventually sit in one of the following five formats. So the first one is the frequency count. And this is a simple tally of the occurrence of an event. So let's say you're looking at a car intersection. You're trying to plan, see if you want to add another lane to your street. And you sit down in that intersection and you start counting the number of cars that pass through that intersection during the day. Then that's a type of frequency count. And then after you are done with the, let's say you're looking at peak time of the day, you have a lot of cars crossing that street, then based on your analysis, you can decide whether or not you need an extra lane. Another example is to look at days without an accident. So that can give you, let's say you're working for an insurance company, that can give you an idea of what type of rate you should charge to different people. So that's a couple of examples for that format. The next format is called raw numbers. And actual amounts are used, usually in comparison to some expected or planned amount, such as dollars spent and hours required. So if you're looking at a very specialized assembly line, let's say you're dealing with a very expensive type of car, you might want to know how long is it going to take you to assemble that type of car. And also that gives you an idea how many hours of labor you're putting into that assemble. So in order to estimate the right price for such a product. The next strategy is called subjective. Numeric ratings. These are usually estimates of some quality offered by specialists in the topic. Rankings of performance and so on. This is a very, I think in industry it's used a lot. That's what we call expert opinion. So if you don't have time to go and collect, let's say 200 data points for an activity, but you know that someone is involved or is very experienced in that process, you can record to ask that person, get their opinion in terms of the observation that they're doing in terms of their experience in that process, and then get an estimate based on that experience. That's something that it's a last resource, like I said, but it's used a lot in industry. Next, the fourth is the indicators. And surrogates. And this is when it's especially difficult to find a direct measure of a variable indicator or surrogate are frequently used instead. So good and bad examples about this specific category. A good example is the body temperature as an indicator of an infection. So that's something that has been used for a long time in healthcare. A bad example is the number of salespersons will be a poor measure of the level of customer service. So having more customer service representatives doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to have a better service for your customer. Okay? So
the last one is called verbal characterization. And other variables that are difficult to measure, such as team spirit or client, might take the form of a verbal characterization. And this is the type of measure that we like to call in industrial engineering qualitative measures. So they are difficult to provide, or it's very difficult to provide a number, but you can come up with a different type of strategy, like good or bad, or that's very simple, and so on. So these are very qualitative characterization of data. So that's the fifth category. Now we're going to transition to data analysis, but before we get to this point, I would like to know if I ask one of you to say, you're working for me, you're working in Johnson & Johnson, and you're in charge of supervising a machine or a production line, and I'm noticing based on your production schedules that you are having some times in the month in which your production is going down, and you basically reported that you have a machine that is giving you problems and you are losing some production because of that machine. So if I ask you, I would like to know what is the time or is an estimate of the next time to failure for this machine, what would you do? And you have, let's say, 2 years of information and you've been observing this behavior in this production line for 2 years. So you have two years of data, and I want you to let me know what will be the estimated next time to failure for the machine. So I can have an idea, okay, I will have that low production on the next 3 weeks, for instance. But I need to know with the number or with analysis, how would you proceed? Yeah, that's the idea. You need to find a pattern. There should be a pattern actually, but you can justify that pattern with some data analysis. And maybe you haven't had that type of experience yet, but I just want to give you an idea of what type of questions can be asked in the future. So you have a problem, and I'm your boss, and I'm telling you, I want to know what will be the next time to failure, or an estimated time to failure for your machine. Yes. So you're going to have, let's say you plot that, you can plot the number of units that you're producing per week. You have your output. You have 100 units this week, 120 next week, and so on. And you come up with this bar chart. And you see your production going up and down and so on. So you can see the pattern. But usually what we do is we get that information and we put it into a input analyzer, which basically is going to take that box plot or that column chart, whatever you have, or historic diagram, and it's going to try to fit a distribution to it, a probability distribution to it. So once you fit that probability distribution, you're going to have it shape fit to that curve or to that pattern. And that distribution is going to give you some parameters in terms of the mean and the standard deviation. So maybe you can fit a gamma distribution to that pattern. You can fit a normal distribution, an exponential distribution. So once you know the type of distribution that that data fit, then you can use the information of the distribution to estimate the next time to fail based on the mean and the standard deviation. So that's the idea. That's what we're trying to do here. We can get some data, but the data itself is not going to tell you a lot. You need to know what to do with that information in order to make it useful for your project. So the data analysis is frequently necessary to analyze or process the data in some manner before reporting it for control purposes. They might take the form of simple aggregation of the data, such as average values, or something as complex as fitting statistical distribution functions. To the data, to a certain relationships, effects, and trends. So this is what I was referring to. You're going to get that data, you're going to fit a distribution, and that distribution is going to basically give you a estimate in terms of what when the next event is going to happen. The asked project manager, however, is much more interested in preventing fires than rather than putting them out. So the value of timely data collection and reporting is important. Another example, as when I was working my PhD, we were involved in a project for planning the, you know, forest fires, in a couple of them last few weeks, to plan the best way to control those fires. So we're receiving data from different sources in Texas, and we're running our experiments, fitting distribution, and telling them, oh, you should put, let's say, a fire station in this area, have a couple of trucks in this area, maybe a helicopter or something like that. So that's an example of how valuable timely data could be in terms of taking actions in preventing damage in terms of the life, people, and houses, and so on. So the next slide, it's basically the same idea that I was discussing. So you can have a frequency chart like this one, a histogram, and then you can try to fit a curve to that data, and that can give you a distribution, and you can use that distribution to estimate the next time an event will happen. So any idea what type of distribution is this one? You don't have to answer, I'm just wondering if anyone knows. Looks like a gamma for me. So, yeah, it's shaped like kind of a normal, but more to the left. And that type of thing is also very useful. So if you can identify the type of distribution that you can have, it's going to help you. So another type of plot is this one. So I'm sure that you have heard about linear regressions, or regression analysis. That's basically what we're doing here. So we are plotting some data points, and then we're trying to fit a regression on that data. So in order, again, to estimate the next time an event will happen. And finally, there's another type of graph that can be very helpful. So ratio of actual
material cost to estimated material cost for aircraft companies. So what you have is a ratio, and you're seeing based on that ratio how the system is behaving based on your time. So if you are going up above that line or below that line, then you can take some preventive actions to control your project.
So I guess, I know this is one of the first courses that you take in this program, project management, but I guess what I'm trying to do here is to motivate you that once you see those things in the future, in your courses, try to pay attention to them because they're going to be related, especially if you end up doing this type of work, and it is very important. So maybe I'm not going in depth because that's not the purpose of this class, but when you look at these things in the future in those courses, try to understand those because they're very important. So data collection, again, very time-consuming, very important. If you are able to do a good analysis, then you are certainly going to be able to get a good model and you're going to get a good analysis. But if you don't get a good analysis, you don't get good data. Something known in the industry as garbage in, garbage out. So if you get poor information, poor data analysis, the result that you're going to get are going to be bad. So this is very important. So data analysis, the next topic is basically reporting and the type of reports. So the project management BOK suggests in the chapter 10 that routine performance, reports include the following things: status reports, progress report, and forecast. So the two graphs that I show you, the linear regression and the data input into the distribution, both of them can help you to provide those forecasts. All table charts, such as the PERT and CPM and Gantt chart, are, and especially plans, should be updated to reflect current reality. So again, going back to those graphs, you see all of them have in their x-axis the time, the number of trials, but those also depend on the time. And here you have the time one more time. So when you're trying to control and monitor your project, make sure that you keep adding information to those analyses because that's going to reflect the current status of your project. Next, everyone concerned with the project should be tied into the reporting, but not everyone needs to receive the same information. And again, this is one of the things that you want to remember. So you're not going to give the same information to your board of directors and the same information to your employees and managers and so on. So your reports needs to be addressing the information that they need. The client may wish to have reports on cost and schedule. Functional management may wish to see reports on technical accomplishments. And project team members may need information at the task or subtask level. And the frequency may be important as well, so they might need the information on a weekly basis or maybe daily basis. When you compare that to your senior management level, they might not need to get the information as frequently. You might be able to process and send the information to them maybe on a monthly basis and so on. If you send a report to senior management on a daily basis, they're not going to read your report. Pretty sure that that's not going to happen. So that's the level of work, and also they might be dealing with other projects as well. So in general, this is a good idea to avoid periodic reports, except in those cases in which the flow of data is periodic, for example, accounting data, and report issues routinely every day, week, month, or quarterly do not get read most of the time. So again, the level of frequency is important. You might not want to send a lot of emails and attachments to people you know are busy, so you want to capture their attention, especially when it's important for your project. For projects, there are primarily three distinct types of reports: the routine, exception, and special analysis. Exception reports are basically, as the word says, for unexpected situations. So if you need, if something is out of control or something unexpected happened in your project, then you might need to create this report to let the people, the important people or the people involved with the project know. Then you have the special analysis report, and this is prepared to disseminate the results of a special study in a project concerning a particular opportunity or problem for the project. Typical subjects: new materials, suppliers, new software, and new regulations. So that type of thing might need to be managed in this type of special analysis report. For instance, new healthcare reform has push some of my projects, so I might need to see how these things affect the outcomes and also the things that we are doing. So for our healthcare projects right now. So for that, we might need to prepare a new report to describe how the projects are going to be affected. Reporting. In addition to the benefits of reports, they provide the mutual understanding between stakeholders. They help communicate the need for coordination among those working on the task and subtask level. They establish and maintain a communication network for global projects, and they help maintain visibility of the project. And visibility most of the time translate to funding. So you want to keep your project visible, especially if you need more money to complete the project. And the project team, to top manager, functional managers, colleagues, and clients. And finally, unless there's a disaster, status report help keep the project team motivated. Okay, so I'm going to stop here today. We're going to continue on Thursday with meetings and discussing the strategy that I mentioned early in this class, the earned value. And that's what we're going to cover on Thursday. Any questions? Okay, so again, one more time, there's a exam next week on Thursday, so make sure that you go over your material and start asking questions about the exam as soon as possible. Okay, so I'll see you guys on Thursday.
Chris?
Yes.
I was wondering if you got my email message
about
the case.
I might. I have to go back. Yeah. Send me a excuse for.
Yeah. I think I read it. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll reply to this today.
Thank you.
Okay.
No, I told you Thursday. I'm just gonna remind you. I won't be here Thursday.
Oh yeah, yeah. I got you. Okay.
You know
where the during the office hours that would be fine. If you want to submit it earlier, there's a mailbox in the main office here.
Okay.
So if you go to the desk, ask where the mailbox is, and
okay.
You can put it there.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
You can check your own. Thank you.